Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Stefan Hendriks, and I'm the head of Cell and Gene at Novartis Oncology. And I'm honored to be joined today by Michael Lehmicke. He is the Director of Science and Industry Affairs of ARM. And ARM is the Alliance of Regenerative Medicine. And Mike and I today will talk about what it meant to make CAR-T a reality. First, by reimagining cancer care, then by generating continuous research, and then advancing the field and questioning what is ahead of us, what's next. So Mike, can you give us a quick overview of your experience with cell and gene therapy, specifically with CAR-T therapy?
Certainly, and thank you for that kind introduction, Stefan. It's my great pleasure to be here with you today and with everyone watching. So my background and exposure to CAR-T, I'm not a healthcare professional, but I've worked in the regenerative medicine field for over 20 years, primarily in research and development. I am a biomedical engineer. I received my master's degree with a focus in tissue engineering from Drexel University. Subsequently, I worked on many projects, biomaterials, cell therapies, and other regenerative medicine projects, leading product development teams. I became aware of ARM, the Alliance for Regenerative Medicine, while I was at Johnson & Johnson as a Johnson & Johnson is a member organization or one of the members of ARM. And I was immediately impressed with the great work that they were able to do as an advocacy group. So I was thrilled to be able to join ARM full time a little over a year and a half ago in the role of Director of Science and Industry Affairs, where I interact with our members on a regular basis on issues primarily related to manufacturing of CAR-T and other cell therapies.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear what has led you to the cell and gene field. This field is so new, so a lot of people involved have very diverse backgrounds. And like yourself, I'm not a healthcare professional, but clearly we share our interest in this field of transformational medicines and the impact it makes on patients. So let's dive in. We called our discussion today the CAR-T revolution and the quantum leap to reality. So the first topic I want to discuss is actually the revolution and the impact cell and gene has for patients. So in your role at the Alliance for Regenerative Medicines, how do you see CAR-T therapy as having revolutionized treatment for patients with different types of blood cancers?
Yeah, so I think when you think about CAR-T as a revolution, which is how we view it, You have to think first about the results for patients, and they've been very promising, at least in certain types of blood cancers. And this is for patients who had relapsed and had multiple lines of other therapies fail, and in many cases, this was their last option. So it's been very beneficial for patients in that sense. I think also from an industry perspective, the cell therapy industry, the CAR-T has really shown what is possible and therefore has lifted the entire industry. And I also think it has started to change the way that we think about drugs. These CAR-T therapies are living therapies and by therefore by their nature, they tend to be very durable. So it's a very different paradigm from the small molecule paradigm or even other biologics. And so I think that the term revolution is very apt here.
Absolutely. And the patients you talk about, the stories that we hear anecdotally, they really motivate us, you know, the cell and gene community and including Novartis to bring those therapies to more patients worldwide. So I was wondering if you could tell us more about the role the Alliance of Regenerative Medicines has in shaping the environment so these CAR-Ts can reach its full potential.
Yeah, so the Alliance for Regenerative Medicine, we are the a membership organization. We have over 370 members currently, including therapeutic developers of all sizes, many of whom are working on cell therapies such as CAR-Ts. We are the premier advocacy group and voice in the regenerative medicine field. We work on initiatives, reimbursement initiatives, legislative initiatives, and regulatory initiatives to streamline the pathway to get these innovative therapies to patients. In particular, what I do at ARM, and one of the key goals of ARM, is to help our members overcome manufacturing hurdles in a pre-competitive space by collaborating on best practices, but also by interacting with the FDA and EMA, who we consider to be partners, on regulatory CMC issues.
Yeah, thank you. And another topic that we might want to dive into related to access to care is COVID-19 situation, the pandemic is impacting all of us. We're all trying hard to put measures in place to address the challenge the virus brings. But for patients, it's very challenging because sometimes we hear concerns about being referred or going to the right treatment centers because of the impact the treatment can have on the immune system, but also, you know, the fact that an IC bed needs to be reserved. So, but the cancer, you know, the risk is if they're not getting treated, the cancer will progress. So I was wondering, you know, your thoughts as a member of this independent organization. What do you think is best for patients, and what can you as an alliance do to support the industry and patients?
So I think you said it. What is best for patients, even in a highly unusual environment like this, where there's a pandemic, which does increase the risk of for immune compromised patients. These are patients with very serious illnesses, cancers, and they need to continue to be treated. What we try to do is be supportive of our members and share information with our members in the right way. There were a lot of concerns initially. People were struggling with getting patients to treatment sites in certain cases that were hotspots for the pandemic. There were initially some manufacturing issues related to transport of cells, getting enough access to personal protective equipment, which is required for the manufacture of these materials. But you know what we saw, and this is reflected in a discussion I had with a lot of our members, is the field has really been resilient, and this COVID-19 has shown the resilience of this field, and that really surprisingly quickly, developers and hospitals, who have to be given a lot of credit, were able to get back to treating patients with CAR Ts and even to restart clinical studies that they had to initially pause enrollment on. So we're hopeful going forward. You know, the pandemic is not over yet, but we are hopeful going forward that the field will emerge even stronger.
Yeah, I agree with you. And also, as a manufacturer, we also do everything we can to minimize the impact on our manufacturing and our supply chain. So I think it's a joint effort to make sure a patient will get the care that they deserve. The next topic, Mike, I want to go into is the importance of the continuation of research for the advancements of the CAR T cell therapy field. I mean, luckily, we see the science moving at fast pace and great momentum. So I was wondering, with what of the recent scientific developments in CAR T space have been most of interest to you?
Oh, great question. There are many. I think in 2020 we saw some additional approvals for liquid tumors, which is exciting. I think we're seeing some positive data in the clinics with CAR Ts looking at alternative targets. Also very exciting. Some things that I have my eye on that are in the clinic now, but maybe a little further down the road in terms of commercialization, are the use of gene editing technologies in TCRs and also CAR Ts to do things like increase the specificity and the durability of these therapies, but also to allow for allogeneic CAR Ts, for example, a potential off-the-shelf therapy, which could be a game changer in terms of being able to scale these technologies and reach more patients.
Yeah, you're very right, Mike. These are very exciting times with everything going on. And it's so important that we continue to generate data to better understand the value these therapies bring and the place they have in the treatment paradigm of our patients. And also, as Novartis, we continue to generate a lot of data in different fields. We want to better understand long-term data of the CAR Ts. We are looking for biomarkers to better understand what are the patients that benefit most. But also, as you said, we're looking at opportunities to find space in other cancers for CAR T therapies or other type of cell therapy. So very exciting times. So talking about data, I would love to hear your perspective on data like these, especially the randomized clinical trials and the health economical data, how they can contribute to realize the full potential of CAR T. So how can these data contribute to patient safety? How can these data contribute to better access of these therapies?
Yeah, so I think it's really critically important to collect real world data, and I commend you at Novartis and others as well for doing that. I think it is the only way in which we, you know, can get a better understanding of the full safety and efficacy profile. And I think as we do that, it will naturally lead to an increased access of these therapies to more patients as reimbursers have a better understanding and confidence about the safety and efficacy profile of these therapies. I also think, you know, we've seen some positive outcomes already in terms of the data influencing CMS, for example, who this year created a new diagnostic related group DRG code for specifically for CAR T, and we think that will be instrumental in allowing more patients to access CAR T therapies.
Yeah, I agree with you. This is an important milestone for patients, especially in the U.S. The next topic I want to touch on with you is, after looking at the importance of research, now talking about the importance of collaboration with different stakeholders to advance the CAR T cell therapy. So, you know, because it's so important, as we discussed already earlier, it's so important that we bring these transformational therapies to more patients worldwide. So I would be interested in understanding what type of collaborations you and the Alliance for Regenerative Medicines are interested in to see the advancements in the field of cell and gene and specifically CAR T cell therapies.
Really, really all types. You know, we sometimes call ourselves the water cooler of the regenerative medicine industry. And I think one of the tremendous things about this industry is the collaborative spirit within it. So we see great collaborations that have happened, as you know, and continue to happen between academic centers where many of these therapies are initially developed, and companies of all sizes, and partnerships between companies small and large around new therapies, but also things like manufacturing technologies and ways to improve the quality of the products. Within ARM, we also have an initiative underway where therapeutic developers who are members are collaborating on a best practices guide or a case study of how to apply quality by design principles to the manufacture of a generic CAR T. And we think that will help to advance the industry even further.
Yeah, thank you. No, and you mentioned collaboration with academic centers, and I mentioned also the progress we want to make in quality of the products. Sometimes collaboration can also be with unconventional partners. As an example, we have a collaboration with the Carnegie Mellon University and also with Microsoft. And what we do with them is using their artificial intelligence engine and advanced analytical models to really look at the different data sets we have, looking for causalities and looking for levers that we can work on to further improve the process, and with that, hopefully, improve outcomes for patients in the future. So very interesting, and sometimes you can look for partnerships where you initially haven't thought about it. So before we close out, Mike, I would love to hear from you about where you see additional opportunities to further advance this field of cell therapies, and what do you expect next from the industry?
Yeah, well, I think just a lot of the things that you mentioned, actually, that industry is doing and that we're trying to support to increase access to these therapies to patients. I think looking at biomarkers and other factors through data analytics to understand what patients are most likely to benefit from these therapies, I think that will potentially lead to these therapies being used earlier in the treatment paradigm of these patients, which my understanding is a lot of physicians think could lead to better results. I think a lot of the these same data analytics that you were referring to, and I'm sure you're thinking about this as well, could be used for manufacturing processes to improve the automation and understanding of things like critical quality attributes of CAR Ts, which will in turn make them accessible to more patients as we were able to make better products and make them in higher quantities at scale. So those are the kind of things that I think about and my expectations when I look forward.
Well, thank you for sharing, Mike. And also thank you so much for joining us today with this thought-provoking discussion on the revolution and the leap forward that CAR T therapies brought to in the treatment of these patients. And we also have to say, we're also very proud of the collaboration we have with the Alliance of Regenerative Medicines. And I hope that the collaboration we talked about with academia, with other industries, with patient organizations, with governments and payers, all together, we collaborate to bring this field forward and bring these transformational therapies to more patients worldwide. So thank you so much.
Thank you. I think, as you said, it's a great spirit. With a great spirit of collaboration that we move forward, and you know, this is too important to do it any other way. And it was a pleasure speaking with you today. Thank you.
Thank you.